Okay, good afternoon, and welcome to this session, which is the International Policymaker Forum on Advancing Inclusive Vocational Training and Employment. I'm Stefan TROEMEL. I work as Senior Disability Specialist in the International Labour Organization based in our headquarters in Geneva. I think it's a very important session, a very important topic that the Zero Project is focusing on at this conference. In parallel to this event, as you know, there's also a meeting, a very interesting meeting also with the private sector today for the first time that this is happening in, with such a focused approach. Policies to promote the employment, vocational training of people with disabilities are still not at the level that they should be. Very often where they exist, they are, have been designed with rather low expectations in terms of what people with disabilities can do. In particular, in developing countries, the large expectation of people with disabilities, their families, policymakers, etc., is that people with disabilities can only find a job in the informal economy. But that is starting to change. And I think this change, which is also led by specific companies in all different countries, needs to be accompanied by relevant changes in the policy environment. Changes that make it easier for people with disabilities and the private sector to find each other. And that, to some extent, is the main focus of the session today. We have time, we have an hour and a bit for this session. As you know, we're starting a bit late. And we have six distinguished panel speakers, all of whom have agreed to try to limit their initial presentations to 6-7 minutes. I will ask each of them one or two questions which they have seen beforehand and to which they have kindly agreed. And we also have a time monitor here sitting in the first row who will show you the time when it's only 2 minutes left or 1 minute left. Let me very briefly present the six speakers. Sitting to my left, Prince Mired Rad Zeid AL-HUSSEIN, President of the Higher Council for Affairs of Persons with Disabilities in Jordan. Thank you. To my right, you've already listened to her in the opening conference, Ms. Daniela Bass, Director of UN DESA in New York. To the extreme left, sitting next to the Jordanian prince, Mr. Shuaib CHALKLEN, founder and chairperson of the African Disability Forum. To my right, Mr. Joseph Jones, executive director of the Harkin Institute for Public Policy and Citizen Engagement in the US. Mrs. Ita MIRIANASHVILI, head of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Unit in the Council of Europe, based in Strasbourg. And to my extreme right, honorary Marek PLURA, member of the European Parliament, in representation of the European People's Party, member of the Committee on Employment from Poland. So I will ask the questions in that exact order. So Prince Mired, I will start with you. And the question that we had discussed before is, what are, in your view, the main challenges for people with disabilities in Jordan to find a job? And how will the new draft law concerning the integration and participation of people with disabilities address these challenges? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I'll try to speak quickly because I've got many, many points that I'd like to make. First of all, I'd like to, on behalf of my delegation, say how pleased and happy we are to be back in Vienna. This is our second time taking part in the Zero Project conference, and I hope in the future we will always take part. Regarding employment in Jordan, Jordan is very much like many other developing countries, and employment for people with disabilities is a big issue. I have identified five areas, or let's say barriers to people finding employment in Jordan. And the number one issue, in my humble opinion, is education. We have a big problem with education back home. Not enough for the percentage of children, young people being educated, those with disabilities is really quite, it's a small percentage. And this of course has a knock-on effect and on the labor market later on. So education is a biggie for us in Jordan, and our goal in the future, one of our goals is how to raise that percentage and get more children with disabilities into school and receiving a good education. The second, I would say, is social barriers, and this is maybe the same in many developing countries, and maybe some developed countries as well. Stereotyping, stigma, discrimination, segregation, the charity mode. You know, when people think of people with disabilities, it's always in that charity mode. The private sector will, if and when the private sector, for instance, when they do hire people, most often, not always, but most often, it's out of charity rather than that because he or she is qualified. And cultural perceptions, I mean, on both sides, from the side of the employer and the person looking for a job, there are cultural perceptions that need to be overcome. Number three is physical barriers. Again, I'm stating the obvious, and I think everyone knows what all of these are. I mean, accessibility is a huge issue for us in Jordan. Public transportation still not accessible. So even if you land a fantastic job and you don't have a car, how are you going to get to your job, and how are you going to get home is a big issue. Places of work in the private sector as well as the public sector are not accessible. The percentage of, say, companies or public sector offices that are accessible or fully accessible is again it's a very small percentage. Let me move on very fast here. Legislative barriers, of course. Again, we have our present law that still overrides our present current law is not sufficient. Because time is running out, I'll be as fast as I can. One of the major problems with the current law is that it allows for employees to decide whether a person is capable or not. And then and very often we have this statute back home, the medical committee statute, which demands that candidates seeking employment have to get checked, medical checkup, and so a medical doctor will decide whether the person can or cannot do the job, and which is absolutely ludicrous in my humble opinion. The last one is financial. It costs money to train and conduct awareness campaigns and so on and so forth. So money has always been an issue for us back home in Jordan. So now the second part of the question is, what are the solutions? We have a new law that is going to be legislated very soon, in the next 2 weeks actually it's going to be legislated. We've been working on it for the last 3 years, drafting this new law. And it's a very progressive, very ambitious law that I think it will be the most progressive law in the Arab world regarding persons with disabilities. And it's the first anti-discrimination law in Jordan. There is a big emphasis on education in the law, schools to make all schools or as many schools as possible to make them inclusive. And also to increase, the number of children with disabilities that are receiving an education, because, like I said earlier, the great majority of children with disabilities are not receiving an education. There will be a big emphasis on training teachers, training administrators, making schools accessible and so on and so forth. So there will be, and this will of course hopefully have a great knock-on effect later on for the labor market. And the more people with disabilities will be qualified and will be, hopefully will be employed because they are qualified and they're able to do the job. So this will be, hopefully will be great. The social barriers, again, there is a great emphasis on our new law that it's a rights-based law. We're moving away from the medical model or the charity model. We're moving away from that. So from once this new law comes into effect, it will be a rights-based approach. We have an equal opportunity committee that will be again be will come about as a consequence of the law, and this equal opportunity committee, which will be from different members or different areas of government and the private sector as well as the civil society, will take part in this committee, and it will have a great effect and support people seeking employment. Again, in the law, there's a big emphasis on accessibility, transportation. All public transport will be accessible, hopefully, in the future. Government buildings, public sector, and private sector have to do a lot to make their facilities accessible. Again, and the new, as for legislation, there will be a stipulation that the private sector as well as the public sector, they have to hire a percentage of people with disabilities, and this will be one of the main pillars of the law. So, just not to go over my time limit. I think I will, one last mechanism I'd like to mention, this law, and within this law we will have a high-level committee which will be chaired by the Prime Minister as an enforcement mechanism, so our Prime Minister and all the relevant ministers will be part of this committee, and the committee will meet once or twice a year to look into all issues related to disability as an enforcement mechanism. So. I think I'll stop here, otherwise I'm going to get reprimanded, so thank you.
Thank you, Prince Mired. Apologies for the time constraints. It's tough to have so many speakers in such a time frame. It's great to see the perspective in Jordan. Jordan, as you will know, played a key role in the negotiation process of the UN Convention. It's great to see your government continuing to be spearheading progress in the area of disability rights. So congratulations to you on that. Over now to Daniela Bass. Those of you who attended the opening session already heard a very inspiring presentation a while ago. Daniela, this time you only have 6 minutes. You cannot go as long as this morning. And I have a very specific question, which I think is particularly relevant also in view of the position you have in the UN, which is the following. The 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development includes explicit references to persons with disabilities, also in its Goal 8, which is the goal about decent work. What are the main initiatives in your division in support of the achievement of these targets? The floor is yours.
Thank you. Whatever time left, I will be later on. I'll give it to the others, rightly so. Goal 8, for those of you who are not familiar with, as my colleague said, deals with sustainable economic growth, full and productive employment, and decent work for all. And definitely it includes also persons with disabilities when it comes to equal pay for work of equal value. And I think this is really what's very important about the Goal 8, the equality and the equity, both. What we do, well, definitely we understand that Goal 4, when it comes to education, is key in order to be employed later on, as Goal 10 is also key. It's about reducing inequalities. And we also know that Goal 11, in order to promote employment, which calls for accessible and sustainable transportation systems, accessible and inclusive societies, are key, as well as, and we keep stressing, Goal 17, partnerships. So what we do in order to facilitate all of these goals that then have an input, a positive one, hopefully, on Goal 8 about employment, We strengthen policy developments by providing analytical and substantive contributions to the intergovernmental processes of the United Nations. The GIA is the biggest intergovernmental process for those of you who are not familiar with the UN system. But we also organize then commissions, each of them specialize in a different topic, and they bring their recommendations to the Economic and Social Council of Ministers, and those recommendations go to the General Assembly, where all members of the UN discuss, and then they decide what are the next mandates. So this is our work, actually, to provide a forum for everybody, all stakeholders, above all member states, to discuss these issues. We, last year, organized a high-level panel discussion that was presided by the President of the General Assembly to consider policy direction and steps for action to realize the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. We also published a report called The World Social Situation, Leaving No One Behind, The Imperative of Inclusive Development, published last year, where we also devoted a chapter on decent work deficits and exclusion and how to overcome them. Early this month, in February, we had the 55th Commission for Social Development, and in it there was a high-level panel discussion on how to strategies to reduce poverty among persons with disabilities, where of course employment, decent work, and vocational training were key in order to reduce poverty. We also provide global forums to fora to facilitate the operationalization of the SDGs, such as, for instance, whenever there are major conferences around the world, we organize, next to this conference, a forum on disability and development, a DSPD DESA forum in conjunction with these conferences. I would like also to say that we collaborate a lot with ILO, because ILO deals with labor. True that in our mandate, deriving from Copenhagen 1995, we have decent work and jobs for all, but definitely ILO is the expert, so we work very closely with the ILO. I'm really very happy about the partnership we have, together with other UN agencies, trusts and funds, definitely. The Conference of the State Parties takes place every year in June, and that's the largest international meeting on disability. So that's also what we do in order to promote discussions about and solutions about disability and employment. Definitely, we have also activities when it comes to capacity building. We have to share our knowledge, and we have this beautiful knowledge from the globe. We receive inputs from 194 countries, from agencies of the UN and many other stakeholders, NGOs, etc. It's wonderful. We have so much knowledge that we have to share. So one of the things we have done when it comes to capacity development, we have developed a toolkit on disability for Africa. And one of the chapters of the 14 is very much devoted to employment and disability. If we find the funds in the future, we would like to develop a toolkit on persons with disabilities for Asia and for all the regions of the world. In addition, since I have only 30 seconds, I believe, or 1 minute, I believe that catalytic projects and activities continued receiving our support through the trust funds that we have on disability, the UN voluntary trust fund. So please contribute to the trust fund, which is administered by the Department of Economic and Social Affairs. I would also like to mention the last thing, the Global Compact, which is a group that works next to the United and close to the United Nations. They work mainly with the private sector, and they are developing guidelines together with us on persons with disabilities and entrepreneurs. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniela. It is obviously a game changer that the Sustainable Development Goals include the many references to persons with disabilities, very different to the previous Millennium Development Goals, where disability was largely invisible. And so I think it's we are a window of opportunity that we are now making much out of it, and I think UN DESA is playing a key role in that, and thank you for that. Next speaker is Shuaib CHALKLEN, again, a person well known in the disability movement. He is the founder and chairperson of the African Disability Forum, but also before that he was the UN Special Rapporteur on Disability, reporting to the Commission for Social Development in New York. Shuaib, in your large experience in Africa and beyond, what would be for you the main challenges that people with disabilities, in particular in Africa, have to find a job, in particular also in the private sector? Thank you.
Thank you, Stefan. You know, I just wanted to start where Daniela left off, asking for contributions to the voluntary fund. Please don't forget the African Disability Forum. But let me start with some positives about Africa. Africa, as you know, is a very large continent, consists of 54 or 55 countries. And one of the positive things, or one of the many positive things, is first of all, out of the 54 countries, probably close to 50 have ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. Almost every single country would have very good legislation and policy on disability. And one of the most important things happening in Africa is that it has seen, in the last 10 years, very good economic growth, average between 6 to 7%. And that's very important. But one of the problems with this economic growth is because it doesn't go with the growth in employment. It's jobless growth. And it's growth, economic growth, that is based on the export of resources, extraction of minerals and oil and gas and those types of things. So it doesn't create a lot of jobs. And it doesn't expand the manufacturing base. So that means that you're always going to have, or for the next foreseeable future, a challenge with creating jobs. Now that's the part of Africa that's also well known. But what is not known is that the 90% of the countries in Africa have no safety net. So we have this continuous cycle of, if there is no safety net, then there is challenges with education and healthcare. And if the state becomes the main employer in the absence of a private sector, that can, a manufacturing sector or a private sector that can create jobs, that means that your expenditure is skewed, and that adds to this continuous cycle. So this is where the SDGs becomes very important. Now, I hope I've answered the question on employment, because I cannot answer this question on employment in the private sector in Africa because the growth is too uneven. So we have to look at what causes this problem. Why is there almost no private sector employment? Because the employment for people without disabilities, the unemployment rate for people without disabilities is close to 40%. So which means you have a large, you have the state that's a main employer, or you have a large informal sector. And then you have this additional challenge of either a poor safety net or zero safety net. And that creates the cycle. So these are the challenges. And this is why, as Stefan mentioned, I'm currently the chairperson of the African Disability Forum. We are putting a great emphasis on the Sustainable Development Goals. As far as we are concerned in the African Disability Forum, that's the only game in town. We're putting all our hopes on this one global program that we hope can assist over the next 15 years in changing the conditions of people with disabilities, not only in terms of employment, but everywhere else. And we are hoping that with a little bit of emphasis on healthcare and education and housing and so forth and transportation, if we look at those, the fundamentals, that if we see an increase in expenditure and a focus on those kinds of things, that the next time we discuss employment for people with disabilities, you know, I can present a more positive picture. Let me just finally say that there are countries that has made tremendous progress, but it's maybe one or two, like South Africa or Kenya. And I know there's somebody who will speak about South Africa and some of its job programs. But the reason is that they have a larger manufacturing base. South Africa is the most industrialized country in Africa, so they can afford to do this. But if you talk about Africa, then it's jobs in the private sector is almost zero for people with disabilities.
Thank you, Shuaib. Thank you, Shuaib, and also particular congratulations for the establishment of the African Disability Forum. I think that is a is a major achievement. I know that you have you played a key role in that, and that is of course recognized by you having been appointed as chair of that. So, great congratulations for that. Moving on to our fourth speaker, Joseph Jones. As I mentioned before, Joseph Jones is the executive director of the Harkin Institute in the U.S. And the question is the following. We are moving now from Africa to the U.S., so please follow us on that trip. Senator Harkin played a key role in the promulgation of the landmark Americans with Disabilities Act. While this has made a huge contribution to promote the rights of persons with disabilities in the U.S., it is often mentioned that employment has been one of the areas where not so much progress has been made. What would be your views on this? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. And I must admit that Senator Harkin is not here with us, and he wanted to be, so I send his regards and greetings as well. This year marks the 27th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act, and although we made a lot of progress to promote the rights of persons with disabilities in the U.S., we know we still have a lot of work left to do. The passing of the ADA expanded greatly the accessibility for thousands of people with disabilities in the U.S., outlining the employment rights of an individual. But it's not a stagnant piece of legislation. We actually have to work to be active in making updates to the ADA in order to make it work in the 21st century. We know what the unemployment numbers are. I won't repeat those. Other people have said those across the world, and in the United States, it's no different for people with disabilities. They suffer with a low or a high unemployment rate as well. And we recognize what several of those obstacles are. There are many of the ones that were mentioned before. There are individual barriers where people choose to exclude themselves from the workforce, lots because of a lack of adequate education or training. There are service barriers, particularly in accessing vocational training and the ability to have good job-seeking services, so they don't really exist much in the United States to help people with disabilities find jobs. Of course, our area of focus is policymaking barriers, knowing that there are lots of discriminatory barriers to overcome in legislation, sub-minimum wage policies that affect many people with disabilities, and the lack of fiscal incentives to hire individuals with disabilities or disability-inclusive employment services, all not being incentivized by a government entity. And lastly but not least, what was mentioned earlier, societal barriers, stigmas against individuals with people against individuals with disabilities in the workplace may also dissuade employers from employing them and individuals from seeking the employment. In the U.S., we tend to sometimes do things very slowly for change, and we continue to spend majority of our public dollars on programs that were designed in the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s. And this was an era when our expectations for employment for persons with disabilities and for community living were much lower than they are today. So we must improve these programs and create new ones in order to promote integrated employment at a competitive wage and give opportunities for entrepreneurship, leading to economic self-sufficiency and independent living for adults with disabilities. There's really a lack of inclusive vocational training, as I said before, that prohibits this from happening. And so for those people who are employed in the U.S. who have disabilities, they're underrepresented in about 16 of 20 of the fastest growing occupations in our country. And the top 20 occupations with the greatest numerical job growth for people with disabilities tend to be the lowest paying, serving as an inadequate mode of financial independence for persons with disabilities. Individuals with disabilities consistently succeed across all industries and are as productive as those without disabilities, as we all know. And to quote our former labor secretary, we focus too much on the first three letters of the word disability and not enough on the last seven. So with that in mind, our recommendations that we look toward making as an institute for our policymakers, both in our state and in our country, are to increase inclusive vocational training in all sectors, to encourage, support, and implement campaigns to educate the public about hiring persons with disabilities, supporting employers who make accommodations for their employees, and creating a working, welcoming, and accessible workplace, and modeling more of the best practices that we've heard about from several of the corporations today for the most vulnerable population in the workforce, and training modules existing for the entire community to be able to get to work. Developing mentoring programs that can help accelerate individuals into the workplace, and then continuing to do research and development on public policies that can be changed or improved in order to make for a more inclusive work environment. That's all I have.
Thank you. Thank you, Joseph. I have for each of the panelists a second question for later on, if time allows. So, but I guess that most of the time will be taken up by questions from the floor, and rightly so. Next speaker, second last, Ita Mirianashvili. I remind you, head of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Unit in the Council of Europe. Now, Ita, the Council of Europe has been very actively over the last month, I guess, because you've just launched a new strategy on the rights of persons with disabilities, 2017-23, which replaces the previous Council of Europe Disability Action Plan from 2006 and 15. And the question tries to basically bridge what are the main lessons learned from the previous action plan and what are the main ingredients and components of the new strategy. The floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Stefan. First of all, it gives me great pleasure to attend the Zero Project Conference and to briefly present the Council of Europe's work in the field of the rights of persons with disabilities. If you do not know my organization, the Council of Europe is a pan-European organization with 47 member states that promotes, protects, and monitors the implementation of human rights for all, including for persons with disabilities. Persons with disabilities are entitled to have access to and enjoy the full range of human rights. These rights are safeguarded by the Council of Europe's European Convention of Human Rights and the European Social Charter, as well as the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities and other international human rights instruments. So, what has that meant so far for us? In April 2006, the Council of Europe's Action Plan 2006-2015 was adopted by member states with the express goal of improving the quality of life of persons with disabilities in Europe. Last year, we took stock of the progress, and we found that the achievements in our member states over the past 10 years are considerable. They include changes in the legislation, service provision, physical environment, and progress towards challenging stereotypes and changing attitudes regarding the qualities and needs of persons with disability. In spite of all these achievements, we also understood that challenges still remain, notably the implementation gap between standards and the reality in the member states. What does this mean in everyday life? It means that the persons with disabilities are still institutionalized against their wish, deprived of the right of vote, exposed to higher risks of violence and abuse compared to the rest of the population, deprived of the right to enjoy arts or to take part in sports, and discriminated when it comes to having access to mainstream education and employment. So based on these findings, the new disability strategy of the Council of Europe 2017-2023 shifts the focus from disability to ability. The strategy has five rights-based priority areas, and they are anchored in the European Convention on Human Rights, and each of them is also connected to the corresponding articles of the UNCRPD, aiming at its implementation in practice. The priority areas are: first is equality and non-discrimination. Second, awareness raising. Third, accessibility. Fourth, equal recognition before the law. And finally, the fifth, freedom from exploitation, violence, and abuse. The priority areas build on and further develop the existing body of work of the Council of Europe, bringing added value to the work done in other regional and international contexts, such as at the level of the UN and the EU. The implementation will be based on so-called twin-track approach, which means that one track comprises of specific projects, such as campaigns, trainings, etc., organized at the national and local levels by national stakeholders in our member states, where us, the Council of Europe, could provide support and input for example, through peer-to-peer exchanges of good practices, studies and research, etc. The second track consists of mainstreaming disability-related issues in all the work and activities of the Council of Europe itself. Finally, to assess the progress in the implementation of the strategy, the Ad Hoc Committee of Experts on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities will prepare biennial reports to be brought to the attention of the Committee of Ministers of the Council of Europe. Ladies and gentlemen, while it is easier to recognize and work towards removing legal or physical barriers, it is much harder to tackle our assumptions, our prejudices, and our stereotypes. Whether it is about collecting data or providing independent expertise and targeted analysis, or still providing advice and training, my organization, the Council of Europe, will strive to improve the everyday life of persons with disabilities. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ita. And it seems that this strategy is really hot from the press, so we're almost among the first to hear about it, so great timing from that point of view. Last, not least of our speakers, thank you for the patience. It's Honorable Marek Plura, member of the European Parliament from Poland, and he will speak in Polish with consecutive translation provided by the colleague sitting next to him, so that means a bit of extra time compared to the other speakers. And the question that we had shared with Mr. Plura is the following. Poland, as many other European Union countries, has a law requiring the private and public sector to employ a percentage of persons with disabilities. What would be your assessment of the effectiveness of the quota system, and what could be improved in your view? Thank you.
Thank you so much. Polska wprowadziła system kwotowy, podobnie jak większość krajów Unii Europejskiej. Analiza skuteczności polityk zatrudnienia osób z niepełnosprawnościami w Unii nie pozwala dzisiaj na jednoznaczne stwierdzenie, że system kwotowy jest bardziej skuteczny od systemu antydyskryminacyjnego, czy też odwrotnie. Dlatego warto zadać kolejne pytania.
Poland introduced a quota system similarly to the majority of the EU member states. Analysis of the efficiency of policies related to the employing persons with disabilities in the EU does not currently give a straightforward answer on whether the quota system is more efficient than the anti-discrimination policy, which is why more questions should be asked.
Należy zacząć od stwierdzenia faktu, że pracodawcy, zarówno prywatni, jak i publiczni, nie są w wystarczającym stopniu zmotywowani do zatrudniania osób niepełnosprawnych. Z drugiej strony, osoby z niepełnosprawnościami nie są gotowe do podjęcia zatrudnienia. W tej sytuacji przyczyn należy szukać głębiej niż w samej konstrukcji systemu kwotowego.
Firstly, neither private nor public employers are currently motivated enough to employ persons with disabilities. Secondly, those people are not ready to begin working. In such a situation, we must look for causes beyond the construction of quota system.
Zacznijmy od osób z niepełnosprawnościami. Ograniczony dostęp do wczesnej interwencji, rehabilitacji, tendencja do wykluczenia z udziału w powszechnym systemie edukacyjnym prowadzi do marginalizacji, izolacji i wykluczenia społecznego. System orzecznictwa ciągle jeszcze nie wskazuje na mocne strony osoby niepełnosprawnej i nie definiuje niezbędnych instrumentów wsparcia w celu niezależnego życia. Orzeka się o niezdolności do pracy. Ja również mam orzeczenie o całkowitej niezdolności do pracy.
Let us begin by persons with disabilities. Limited access to early intervention and rehabilitation, as well as a tendency to be excluded from the education system, lead to marginalization, isolation, and social exclusion.
the disability assessment system still does not focus on the strengths of people with disabilities and fails to identify the necessary instrument for reaching autonomy. Disability assessment institutions decide on inability to work. I, too, have a judgment declaring total inability to work.
System rentowy jest tak skonstruowany, że w przypadku podjęcia pracy, co zawsze wiąże się z ryzykiem, traci się świadczenia pieniężne. Niewielkie, ale pewne. Należy dodać jeszcze brak wsparcia w kształtowaniu kluczowych umiejętności i ograniczoną dostępność asysty. To są czynniki, które ograniczają zarówno możliwości, jak i motywację osób z niepełnosprawnościami do podejmowania zatrudnienia.
The pension system is constructed on such a manner that upon beginning employment, which always entails a risk, a person will lose this limited but secure revenue. Lack of support for fostering key skills and limited assistance should also be mentioned. All those factors limit both the possibilities and the motivation to find employment for persons with disabilities.
Jak wygląda to od strony pracodawcy? Niewątpliwie barierą po stronie pracodawców jest obawa przed problemami związanymi z zatrudnianiem osób z niepełnosprawnościami. Obawiają się oni zarówno problemów zdrowotnych, zagrożenia utratą ciągłości realizacji zadań, nie mają wiedzy o niepełnosprawności, boją się kosztów związanych z zatrudnieniem.
How does it look from the side of employers? The fear of problems linked with hiring persons with disabilities is certainly a barrier for employers. They are worried about health problems and the loss of work continuity. They lack knowledge of disability and fear the cost associated with such employees.
Pracodawcy nie chcą wikłać się również w biurokrację związaną z uzyskaniem i rozliczaniem dotacji. W sektorze publicznym niezatrudnianie osób z niepełnosprawnościami zawsze jest do uzasadnienia brakiem kandydata o odpowiednich kwalifikacjach. Co można i należy zrobić w tej sytuacji, aby osiągnąć wzrost zatrudnienia osób z niepełnosprawnością?
Employers are also unwilling to get entangled in the bureaucracy related to securing subsidies. In the public sector, non-employment of persons with disability is usually justified by the lack of candidates with appropriate qualifications. What can and should be done in such a situation in order to increase the number of employees with disabilities?
Myślę, że mechaniczna zmiana systemu kwotowego na antydyskryminacyjny nie jest rozwiązaniem. Analiza skuteczności polityk zatrudnienia osób z niepełnosprawnością w Unii Europejskiej nie wskazuje jednoznacznie przewagi jednego systemu nad drugim. Co więcej, coraz więcej państw członkowskich zaczyna stosować połączenie systemu kwotowego z antydyskryminacyjnym. Jest to logiczne w kontekście konwencji ONZ.
I think that a switch from the quota system to anti-discrimination policy is not a solution, since studies undertaken in the EU do not give conclusive results concerning the superiority of the one system over the other. An increasing number of member states is beginning to use a mix of the two systems. It is logical with the context of the EU convention.
Po to, aby zwiększyć zatrudnienie osób z niepełnosprawnością, musimy.
To increase employment of persons with disabilities, we must.
Poprawić dostęp do wczesnej interwencji i rehabilitacji.
Improve access to early intervention and rehabilitation.
Zapewnić dostęp do powszechnego systemu edukacji.
Grant access to the general education system.
Zmienić system orzecznictwa.
Change the judiciary system.
Zapewnić, żeby świadczenia rentowe były związane ze zwiększonymi kosztami utrzymania i nie przepadały wraz z podjęciem zatrudnienia.
ensure that pensions are linked with higher cost of maintenance and are not removed when employment begins.
Zwiększyć dostępność asysty osobistej.
Increase the availability of personal assistance.
Uprościć procedury przyznawania dotacji na zatrudnienie, na przykład poprzez wprowadzenie vouchera lub budżetu osobistego.
Simplify procedures related to securing subsidies, for example, through vouchers or personal budgets.
Utworzyć system wsparcia pracodawców, tak aby zatrudnianie osób z niepełnosprawnością nie wiązało się tylko z problemami.
Create a system of support for employers, so that employing persons with disabilities is not only linked with problem.
Prowadzić stałą kampanię w celu poszerzenia świadomości w zakresie zatrudniania osób z niepełnosprawnością. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Plura. Interesting to see the reference also to the disability assessment process that also Prince Mired, you mentioned as one of the problems that people with disabilities face when this assessment is purely medical and focusing on what people cannot do instead of focusing on what they can do. No? It's a very frequent thing, and we are starting as UN agencies to work together to try to give some guidance on how that can be improved. I have been told that we can go on for another 20 minutes. So you should be getting ready in a minute to make some good and short, very short, questions or comments. But before that, I'm taking the liberty as moderator to ask a second question to just one of our panelists, because I was particularly embarrassed, Prince Mired, to see you struggling through the time constraints. And the second question, in fact, that we had prepared for you is particularly important, because it relates about the situation of women with disabilities. And I think it's very important that we devote a bit of time to the specific additional challenges of women with disabilities, especially in a region like the Arab region, where in general the employment levels of women are far below those of men. Prince Mired.
Thank you, sir. How much time do I have? It is a fact that my country is a very male-dominated country, but that doesn't mean there is no hope or that all is lost. On the contrary, I think with our new law, which is a very anti-discriminatory law, and I hope to God that it will be legislated without too many deletions in Parliament. I'm very hopeful. I do think also that civil society back home in Jordan needs to step up and play a larger role. I think the disabled people's organizations need to also step up. The organizations at the moment are, I wouldn't say very mature. They need to maybe mature more and lobby more and become more active. And I think that will be a great help. I think once people with disabilities in Jordan are able to vote, only a small percentage actually go and vote in our parliamentary elections and our municipal elections, I think that will have a big effect also. And to tell you the truth, I'm not so worried about our girls, because our girls are our best students in our schools and in universities. By far, there's a big disparity between girls and boys and when it comes to grades. So there's more hope for our girls than for our boys, I think. And in actual fact, just two weeks ago, a blind girl got the highest mark in the high school exam. A blind girl got the highest mark in our high school exam, which is the Tawjihi exam. So there's a lot of hope, I think. And just the last thing, there's a last issue, last point. There's a great emphasis on the emancipation of women in Jordan and getting women more and more into the workforce, because that will help us keep our high birth rate down. I mean, the more women in the workforce, the more the birth rate will come down, and that's something that we aspire for. So thank you.
Thank you, Prince Mired, and thank you for the co-panelists to allow me to make this well-deserved exception. We have now about 10 minutes to get questions and comments from the floor. I guess we are sitting here in a place where we can't see you almost, because we have like lights on us as if we were going to be interrogated by the police. But I can see a few hands over here, and I guess somebody has a microphone, which I don't know. Ah, sorry, everyone has a microphone. Okay, so the gentleman next to Eric, and then I go to the first floor, and then let's see.
Thank you. I am from Azerbaijan, and I represent via Cox's Children Network, Israel Iskenderov. I would like to bring your attention to two things. First of all, about commuter-level disability, because everybody are discussing here very high-level problems, but please give attention in community level that there are no technology or very less level technology, and access to vocational training, it is impossible. And the second suggestion is to why we are thinking only vocational skills training. I think world are already using company-based training, and I hope that you can give suggestion to local government about to develop local, company-based or apprenticeship activities, that informal education, that it can give more result than vocational skills training, because for vocational skills training it needs place and access, possible to access for people, but for community level it will be better to have access in near the business. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Let me just take the point about apprenticeship, because in the global challenge to promote youth employment, not just people with disabilities, not just youth with disabilities, in general, apprenticeship schemes is one of the avenues that has been agreed at global level. And in fact, the ILO and in collaboration with the International Organization of Employers has promoted a global apprenticeship network, which is setting up national apprenticeship networks in many countries. What we need to ensure from the disability side is that these national apprenticeship networks are inclusive of apprentices with disabilities. Mm-hmm. So I think thank you for bringing that to our attention. Eric Chang from UNDESA.
Thank you very much. It is very interesting discussion over here. I have a question perhaps to Joseph and Ita in terms of a policy recommendation to member state, for example, a hacking institution to the current administration of United States, regarding to how promote further the opportunity of job opportunity and employment of persons with disability. It seems to me policy approaches over here. And the United States was cited as an example, have this non-discrimination legislation and robust enforcement, where in other cases we see targeted actions and twin approach towards this issue. And why, for example, there are questions asked by the moderator, why you have these 20 years of an implementation of ADA, American Disability Act, well, the employment rate is relatively still low. So how you overcome these difficulty and challenge and make more progress? In the European Council, European Union actually, on the one hand, you are improving your policy legislation, but it seems to me you also have quite a lot of affirmative actions in a number of member states. So the question, again, back to the question I asked, is how you are going to advise with innovative ideas based on solution you see in both public and private sector. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. I will give time to answer, first to think about the question. The question was not easy, so you have a few minutes to think about it. But I will finalize first to get a few more comments from the ground, and then I will give the final 5-6 minutes, more or less each 1 minute to each of the panelists, and then you should try to answer some of the issues that came up from the floor. I have now Ingrid here in the first floor, and a gentleman over there, and a gentleman over there. So I have 3 speakers, 4, and I don't think I will be able to have more. So Ingrid, you start.
Yes. Thank you, Stefan. Here's Ingo Tainer from the World Future Council. I would like to ask a question to, in particular, to Mr. Jones. The US has a new president since January who, amongst, besides a new wall, he promised also many jobs. So what do you expect from him in terms of the rights of persons with disabilities?
Okay, interesting question. I will go back behind Ingrid, the gentleman with the nice tie, yeah? Please, just put on the...
Okay. My name is Omar. I have a question for Prince Mired. My question is, one of the solutions you said was forming a committee. And me as a citizen of Jordan, I don't think that such a committee can make a big difference as laws have been implemented already and not a big response has been made by the private sector and by the citizens of Jordan. So what does the press think?
Okay, some young skepticism about the committees, which we'll be happy to answer. The gentleman over there with glasses, yes.
Thank you. So I come from Spain, and in Spain we have the both in the private and the public sector companies or the public institution must hire a certain percentage of persons with disabilities, and enterprises that hire people with disabilities also receive a direct economic aid, and so on. So, but that doesn't work. The unemployment rate of persons with disabilities in Spain is still very high. So I think, I doubt of the usefulness of these legal measures, legal incentives to the inclusion of labor, inclusion of people with disabilities. I think we must explore completely new ways. I don't know which are these new ways, but I think the legal measures we are used to do not work in practice. What's the view of the panelists?
Okay, thank you. Well, just a very quick reaction, as an ILO, we would not undermine the role of legal measure and incentives, but it's true that they are not enough. I think we need to find additional things. I would not throw them away, because I think some of the changes have been happening thanks to that, but definitely they have not, and we saw the example from the ADA in the US, they in themselves will not achieve the objective we all have. I will give one more floor. I can see a gentleman just down there. Yes, you have the hand up, please go
okay,
ahead.
Thank you very much. My name is Bhaskar Bhattacharji. I am from Bangladesh. I am a person with visual disability. Friends, believe me, if community have respect and positive thinking, then people with disabilities could be a strong workforce. I was struggle years and years to get a job. I didn't get a job. And I started with a local NGO with a $50 per month salary after 5 years of waiting. Believe me, now I am recruited as a national consultant accessibility at Prime Minister office. As a blind person, in a country like Bangladesh, it is an example. We struggle, finally we are successful, and we've proven our ability. So acceptance of people with disabilities is very important. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. So I will now go back to the panel. Please feel free to comment to any of the issues that were raised, particularly those that were raised directly to you. But all that in 1 or 2 minutes maximum, and also think about what sort of take-away message you want to include in that. I'll start, Joseph, with you, if that's okay.
Well, thank you for your questions. I think that I have a couple things to address at some point. I want to first just say that it's a great opportunity to be here, and it's things like this that actually will help to push some of the policy changes that need to occur, hearing from the individuals who are doing this on a regular basis and getting that information back to our policymakers in the U.S. is really important. I also wanted to mention that one of the things that we're doing as an institute is we started our first Harkin International Disability Employment Summit that happened last December. I think many people in this room were there. And we're able to pull together people from the business sector, both corporations, microenterprises, smart startup businesses, along with academics and NGOs and government, all to talk about more inclusively putting people with disabilities in the workforce around the world. And that includes in the US. And from that, we hope to produce several sets of policy recommendations that we can make both for the government sector, but also for the business sector. I think there's gonna be a combining of processes both to incentivize businesses to employ persons with disabilities, but also to get businesses to understand and see that it is not a huge hurdle to make some of those accommodations that need to be made. It's just a matter of them seeing that modeled from other businesses. So that'll come from both sectors. And yes, it has taken a while to evolve to get to jobs. It was really getting the foot in the door when we initially started ADA in our country to even recognize people with disabilities as being just regular people. And so now we're at that stage where we need to talk about that in the workforce, and moving that into that arena has been the goal of the Harkin Institute's disability work since our inception. As far as employing persons with disabilities in terms of the large jobs that were promised by the current administration, we'll see. It's only been a month. It's been a long month for some, but it's been a month. And we will remain cautiously optimistic that those jobs will be created, but also that the new labor secretary will keep into consideration people with disabilities as they are looking for meaningful work in our workforce.
Thank you, Joseph. Good luck with that. Ita, over to you.
Yes, thank you for your question. Eric, right? Hi. I have to make a distinction. I think there was a slight confusion between my organization and European Union. We are not the same, which also means that the strategy which we just elaborated is not binding instrument for the member states. We come together by consensus, and all the different priorities are chosen together by 47 member countries. Therefore, we can only advise them. We can use an opportunity to remind them the obligations that majority of 44 members of 47 member states that we have signed the UNCRPD. Therefore, we can only remind them the obligations that they have to undertake. But we can only be guiding them rather than giving them the binding instrument and saying you have to do this and that. So that also means that once we get together and once we decide to implement something, this is a consensus of 47 member states. And usually countries are very committed. Again, these five priorities have been crystallized after almost a year and a half of negotiations, and every single member state that is part of our committee that deals with the issues of persons with disabilities is committed regarding all these five priorities. And hopefully in 2023, I will be here again and we will be able to discuss what has happened and how the strategy was implemented, and I can give you the results then. Thank you.
Thank you, Ita. Prince Mired.
Thank you, Omar, for the very difficult question. Actually, it pleases me so much to see you here because, I mean, you give me hope, and I hope in the future that you will help champion this cause in Jordan. And like you, I don't like committees too much. And sometimes back home, we form a committee to form a committee. And so I agree with you. But I think on the point of the point that I made was regarding the Equal Opportunity Committee. And if hopefully, if managed correctly and if managed in the right way, it will be chaired by our Secretary General of the Higher Council, who's a blind gentleman who just recently was appointed as our Secretary General for the rights, or the, for the Higher Council for the Rights of People with Disabilities, and he's an absolutely fabulous gentleman and extremely, extremely bright. And I think the first time in Jordan that an individual of his magnitude has been appointed at the executive level. So we're very proud of him, and he's going to manage this committee. And it's an enforcement mechanism to make sure that people with disabilities are able to find employment. And if they don't find employment, or they're forbidden or not given jobs because of their disability, then that we can take them to town on that. So hopefully it will be an effective committee, and it's one of my jobs to make sure that it will be an effective committee. So, thank you.
Thank you, Prince Mired. Mr. Plura, from the member of the European Parliament, he will answer or make some comments to the question raised by a gentleman from Spain. So, Mr. Plura, please.
Bardzo dziękuję. Jestem przekonany, że dla pozytywnych zmian na rynku pracy osób z niepełnosprawnościami konieczne jest, aby zostały spełnione trzy podstawowe warunki.
Thank you very much. I'm convinced that to improve the situation of persons with disabilities on labor market, there are three necessary conditions.
Osoby z niepełnosprawnością muszą być odpowiednio przygotowane i wyposażone do podjęcia zatrudnienia.
Firstly, persons with disabilities must be well prepared and equipped to start employment.
Niezbędna jest motywacja do wyboru zatrudnienia w miejsce zasiłku i bierności.
They must be motivated to choose work instead of pension and inactivity.
I wreszcie po trzecie, konieczne jest przygotowanie i motywacja pracodawcy.
And finally, thirdly, employers must be motivated and prepared to hire person with disabilities.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Plura. Also, thank you for the previous very thorough diagnostic that you made, and this suggestion that quota and anti-discrimination should be combined, which I fully would agree with. A final 1 minute message to take home, both from Shuaib and Daniela. Daniela, do you want to start?
Yes. Caught by surprise. Two things. Fairy tales have two effects. Positive, negative, depends. Fairy tales talk about dreams. Dreams can become reality, illusions don't. Fairy tales, though, can also keep transmitting and transferring stereotypes, and that will hamper what we're trying to achieve here today. An example, we should teach our children that what the symbols of fairy tales. Captain Hook, disabled, evil. The witch in Snow White, deformed body, evil, bad, and a few others I could mention right now. So without even realizing it, we keep teaching fear and stereotypes and taboos to our children. Stories are good. They were created for a reason, these fairy tales. But we have to teach our children what they meant in those times, okay? No censorship, just explaining things. And the other thing that you might wish to take away with you, and I loved it. Let's leave the dis at home and bring here abilities. Thank you.
Thanks, Stefan. I just wanted to mention a few things. One that I was asked to speak on Africa, and the one thing I forgot earlier to mention is the strength of civil society organizations in Africa. The one advantage we have very strong DPOs, very strong organizations of people with disabilities, and that's why we could form the African Disability Forum and have that level of support that we have now throughout Africa. Now, that's not an automatic thing, and I mean, as you mentioned earlier, I was the previous special rapporteur for the UN on disability, and it's not the same in every part of the world. There's regions in the world where there's very weak civil society organizations and almost no DPOs. So that's a great advantage for the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals, because we are hoping and we are working towards improving the capacity of civil society to monitor the implementation of the SDGs, of those goals over the next 15 years. And we're hoping that if civil society is strong enough to hold government to account, then we would see some real delivery on the ground. And in that process, hopefully, also that the capacity of the state to provide those services will improve. So that's my final thoughts on where we're going in Africa and with the African Disability Forum. Thanks.
Thank you, Shuaib. And I think that's a very nice way to finish the roundtable with a message of optimism and action-oriented optimism, I would say. So thank you to all the co-panelists. I think they deserve another round of applause. And also thank you for the audience. Yeah.